Allahu Akbar.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Anbiya'i wal Mursaleen. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin. Amma ba'd. All thanks and praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may His peace and blessings upon His last and final messenger, His family, His companions, and those who follow them until the end of times. In Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this very beautiful description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He tells us, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. That truly there is a good example. Truly there is a best role model in the Messenger of Allah for the one who hopes in Allah and the last day and remembers Allah much. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the last and final messenger, the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the leader of the prophets and messengers, is the absolute most perfect example of a human being to ever walk on the face of this earth. He is the best example, the best role model for us to follow in every single aspect of our lives. And amazingly, every minute detail of his life has been preserved for us. It has been documented for us through the efforts of those who loved him the most, his companions, radiallahu anhum, and the great scholars of hadith. And by reading these narrations, by reading these traditions, we get a complete picture of what type of individual the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam truly was. These narrations, they paint a picture of a very beautiful human being, someone who was beautiful both inwards and outwards. And that beauty exemplified itself particularly in his character. The way he carried himself, the way he behaved, the way he spoke, the way he interacted with others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He praises him in the Quran by saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. That you, O Prophet, are on this exalted standard, this exalted level of character. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was well-mannered. He was easygoing, he was friendly, he was affable, he was approachable, he was available, he was simple and humble, he was generous, compassionate, caring, kind, merciful, forbearing, and patient. Any good quality, any good characteristic you can think of, it was exemplified and modeled by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the most beautiful qualities he was given is something which is known in Arabic as al-hilm. So the word hilm in the Arabic language, it has several different definitions. So one of the definitions that's given is patient deliberation, or simply patience, or perhaps careful thought, even intelligence. It's the opposite of being rash, the opposite of being reckless. So it can be thought of as self-control. Specifically, the ability to control yourself when you're upset. The ability to control yourself when someone is provoking you. So it's this composure, it's this calmness at the time when your temper is flaring. And the best way to honestly describe hilm is this self-restraint and this self-control. And when we look towards the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find this quality, this trait being exemplified in several different ways. So in today's session, I just want to share one incident from his life where we get a glimpse into the hilm, the forbearance, the patience, the deliberation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So there's a companion by the name of Zayd ibn Sa'na radiallahu anhu. Before accepting Islam, he was a very famous rabbi, a well-known rabbi, extremely knowledgeable in the city of Medina. And he himself says that I had been studying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from a distance. I had been observing him, looking at his behavior, and I noticed that he carried all of the qualities and all of the characteristics that were mentioned in the Torah regarding the awaited Prophet. So he himself says that there weren't any signs of prophethood except that I saw them in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when I looked at his face. But there were two qualities that I couldn't tell just by looking at him. يَسْبِقُ حِلْمُهُ جَهْلَهُ. That his forbearance outdoes his anger. That when people provoke him, when people make him upset, he carries himself with composure. وَلَا تَزِيدُ شِدَّةُ الْجَهْلِ عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا حِلْمًا. And the more people provoke him, the more forbearing, the more patient he becomes. So he says, I was constantly looking for this opportunity to teach, to see if the Prophet ﷺ had these two qualities and characteristics as well. So he mentions that one day, he came out of his house accompanied with Ali radiallahu anhu. And as they're walking in the streets of Medina, a Bedouin comes to them and says, Ya Rasulallah, there's this group of villagers who accepted Islam because of me. And I had told them that if they became Muslim, then their rizq, their sustenance will come to them in abundance. They won't have to worry about being financially in a financially difficult situation, that they'll live a life of prosperity. But it just so happens, since the moment they accepted Islam, they've been going through hardships and they're experiencing a drought. So if you have any charity, please give it to me so I can help them. So the Prophet ﷺ, he looks towards Ali radiallahu anhu, and Ali radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah, we don't have anything left to give. So Zayd, he's saying that I was overhearing this entire conversation. So I approached the Prophet ﷺ, I told him that why don't you sell me a certain quantity of dates? I will give you the money up front, and you can give me the dates later on. And this is actually a type of sale which is mentioned in the books of jurisprudence. It's called bay' al-salam. It's a forward sale where the purchaser, the buyer, they give the money up front and then the seller gives the product at a later agreed upon date. So the Prophet ﷺ, he agreed to this. Okay, I'll take the money now and I'll give you these dates later on. And he gave this money to the Bedouin and he said, go to those people and be fair, be just with them. So now Zayd says, a few days before the appointed term, the Prophet ﷺ, again, he's coming out of his house, and this time he's with a group of companions. Amongst them are Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman radiallahu anhum, and several other companions. And he says, I went up to the Prophet ﷺ with a very angry face, and I grabbed him by his shirt, and I pulled him violently towards me. And then I started looking at him with this really dirty look. He says, نَظَرْتُ إِلَيْهِ بِوَجْهٍ غَلِيذٍ. I gave him like the stank eye, I gave him a really nasty look. And then the Prophet, he says that I grabbed him by his shirt and I actually insulted him and I yelled him. I said that, won't you give me what's mine? Won't you give me my right? And O sons of Abdul Muttalib, you are known to not pay back your loans. And he's saying, while I'm saying this, I'm looking at Umar radiallahu anhu and he's upset. He says that his eyes are literally going around in circles. And Umar radiallahu anhu at that moment actually threatens him. He says that, أَتَقُولُ مَا أَسْمَعُ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Are you saying what I think you're actually saying to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? أَتَسْنَعُ بِهِ مَا أَرَى. Are you doing what I see you doing to him? If it were not for the fear of the consequences of my actions, I would have struck your neck right now. Meaning I would have just taken care of you. And for those of you who are familiar with Umar radiallahu anhu, that's who he was, right? He was a very strong personality. And it's mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this whole time did not say a word. He stood there silently with a smile on his face, right? He let Zayd grab him by the shirt. He let him pull him violently. He let him speak ill towards him. And then he allowed this conversation to take place. And then after Umar radiallahu anhu said what he needed to say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not get upset at Zayd, but he got upset at Umar. And he told him, Ya Umar, هو وأنا كنا أحوج إلى غير هذا. That, O Umar, him and I were in need of something other than that. Meaning that the response you gave, that's not the correct response. That's not the right way to react. That's not the right way to respond. أن تأمرني بحسن الأداء. You should have simply told me to give back what his right is. وأن تأمره بحسن اتباعه. And you should have told him to ask for it in the best way possible. So Umar, take him, give him his right, give him his dates, and give him more on top. Give him something extra on top. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he takes Zayd, he gives him that amount of dates, and he gives him a lot more as well. So now Zayd is a little bit shocked that, you know, I only was supposed to get like 10 kilograms of dates, and I'm getting 20. What's going on? So Umar radiallahu anhu told him that, look, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me to give you more because I scared you, because I threatened you. So to make up for that, he told me to give you back some more. So then Zayd asked Umar radiallahu anhu, hey, don't you recognize who I am? And Umar's like, no, I don't know who you are. So he says, my name is Zayd ibn Sa'na, the famous rabbi of Medina. So now Umar radiallahu anhu, he's a little bit shocked. He's a little bit confused that if you're a rabbi, that means you're supposed to be someone who also has good character. That you know you're not supposed to engage with people like that. You're supposed to have good dealings. And you should not have spoken to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like that. So why did you do so? So he responded by saying, look, I didn't mean anything that I said. And I didn't want to insult him intentionally, but I was simply trying to see if he possessed these two qualities. If he possessed the characteristic of hilm, and the fact that when someone provokes him and makes him angry, he becomes more patient and more forbearing. And he says, this is exactly what I saw in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that I came and I grabbed him by his shirt. I pulled him violently towards me. I gave him this dirty look. I insulted him and his family. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not reciprocate. He did not say anything. He didn't yell. He didn't, you know, scream at me. And he didn't have me beat up by his companions. Because again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's surrounded by his companions as well. So it says, "Ushhiduka ya Umar, I make you a witness, O Umar, raditu billahi rabba, that I am pleased with Allah as my Lord, wa bil Islami deena, with Islam as my religion, wa bi Muhammadin nabiyya, and with Muhammad as the last and final prophet." And then he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he declared his shahada as well. He says, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka 'abduhu wa rasuluhu." That I testify that there's nobody worthy of worship except Allah, and that you are his last and final messenger. So this is a very, very beautiful incident that highlights the hilm, the self-restraint, the self-control, the forbearance, the patience, the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's through this noble character, through this noble attribute, that Zayd was actually led into Islam. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by having this brief exchange with him, by having this brief interaction with him, was able to open up his heart. And through that interaction, he was able to enter into Islam. And through this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was actually modeling the Quranic narrative of what character should be like. That there are several passages in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the people of taqwa, where he describes the people of God consciousness. And in one of those, he says that when the people become angry, they swallow their anger. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ, meaning when someone provokes them, when someone pushes their buttons, when someone makes them angry, they literally swallow their anger. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and then they forgive people. Meaning not only do they swallow their anger and control their temper, but they actually forgive the person that's upsetting them. They forgive the person that's provoking them, that's making them upset. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and then they do good to those people. And this is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ did at this moment. That obviously as a human being, every single one of us experiences anger. This is a natural human emotion that all of us have. We've all had those instances where people have said something to us or done something to us that makes us really upset. But at that moment, we are being told to swallow that anger. Let it go. Just forgive people. Afin, forgive the people or the person who did that to you, and in return, do something kind to them. And that is exactly what we saw from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now this incident, it has several lessons, several morals that we can derive from it. But the one I want to highlight today is the fact that he was actually training Umar radiallahu anhu. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not leave behind a legacy of written works. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not leave behind a legacy of books and literature. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he left behind a legacy of amazing individuals, both men and women, who were able to transform their society. And the reason why he was able to do that is because he was giving them this prophetic tarbiyah. He was giving them this proper nurturing, this upbringing, this training, this education, and this proper behavioral and how to behave. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is known to be the best murabbi, right? The best one to give tarbiyah. And tarbiyah, it literally means to nurture, to develop, to cause something to grow and prosper stage by stage until it reaches completion. So when you're giving tarbiyah, you're training someone step by step. You're giving them piecemeal information and you're allowing them to prosper stage by stage. And you're nurturing them, you're educating them, you're training them, and you're refining, most importantly, their character. The way they speak, the way they behave, the way they interact with others. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was teaching Umar radiallahu anhu a very important lesson here. That when someone provokes you, when someone makes you upset, when someone makes you angry, you're not supposed to respond in kind. Rather, you are supposed to respond with hilm, with forbearance, with patience, with humility, with kindness, with compassion, and with forgiveness. And this is the nature of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, how do we translate that into our lives here today? Right? How is it that we can get this type of tarbiyah, this type of training, this type of nurturing? So I would suggest that one of the most important things for all of us here is to have proper mentorship. And that's one way we can understand this concept of tarbiyah. That's one way we can understand who a murabbi is. A murabbi is actually a mentor. Someone who has the best interest of yours in mind. Someone who's concerned about your well-being, physical, emotional, spiritual, in every single aspect of your life. Someone who gives you good counsel, good advice. Someone who has a shoulder you can lean on, you can look up to, and you can always come to them when you're struggling. So finding a mentor is something that is really, really important for all of us here, especially for those of us who are younger. If you're like in high school, college, it is absolutely essential to have a mentor in your life, someone whom you look up to. And obviously, when looking for a mentor, you should look for several qualities. And the most important being knowledge, but along with that knowledge, good character. That the person you're choosing as a mentor is someone who models the behavior of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? In their speech, in their behavior, in their interactions with others. But mentorship is a two-way street, right? Not only is it important to have a good mentor, but as a mentee, you have to be someone who's willing to listen. So one of the most important qualities of this relationship is something that is known in Arabic as mushawara or mashwara. Right? Consulting with your elders, consulting with people who have life experience. That you're going to be going through struggles and issues and problems. You might need to make some decision in life. You should be able to go to this mentor and consult with them. Right? Have a discussion with them. And that they have this sincere concern for you, so they're going to give you good advice. But accepting that advice as well. Right? Being someone who's willing to learn, willing to listen, and learn from their experience, and learn from their expertise, and most importantly, learn from their life experience. And I cannot overemphasize how important this is for all of us. Because obviously, as some of the speakers before me mentioned, that life is one of the best teachers. Right? Just the fact that you have experience and you've gone through several things, it is the absolute best teacher a person can have. So listening to this person and taking their advice can help you and save you from falling into several different traps. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, to give all of us the tawfiq, the ability to be amongst those who follow in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us this quality of al-hilm, to give us forbearance and patience, to be able to control our anger and control our tempers, to respond to people who make us upset with kindness and generosity. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to also help us find great mentors and to be good mentees and to learn from their experiences and to learn from their teachings as well. جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.